Bienvenidos. La Sugerencia Cultural del Banco de la República les da la bienvenida a la 18ª versión de la Cátedra Internacional de Arte Luis Ángel Arango, promovida por la Fundación de Amigos de las Colecciones de Arte del Banco de la República. Quiero agradecer a las diversas instituciones que se han vinculado a esta versión, el Instituto Goethe, la Universidad Jorge Tadeo Lozano, el Museo de la Tertulia de Cali y el Instituto Distrital de las Artes y de Artes. Y saludar, por supuesto, al Comité de la Cátedra, conformado por Beatriz González, Beatriz Salazar, Lucas Ospina, Natalia Ruiz y Catalina Casas. La Cátedra de Arte fue concebida en el año 1991 como un escenario de debate sobre los principales aspectos teóricos de la creación y la estética contemporánea. Las 17 versiones realizadas hasta hoy han sido lideradas por grandes catedráticos de diferentes partes del mundo, como Hal Foster, Mari Carmen Ramírez, Luis Pérez Oramas, Estrella de Diego, por nombrar solo algunos. Estos encuentros han reunido un público muy diverso, generalmente compuesto por estudiantes de arte, de arquitectura, filosofía e historia, docentes, historiadores y críticos de arte, profesionales de museos, intelectuales, coleccionistas de arte, y estamos muy contentos de verlos a todos ustedes aquí hoy. Nos complace ver que cada año la cátedra atrae a más gente de diversas procedencias. Bienvenidos por los días que vamos a estar aquí. Muchísimas gracias al profesor Grois por acompañarnos. Bienvenido a Colombia.
Muy buenas noches. En nombre de la Fundación de Amigos de las Colecciones del Banco de la República, quiero agradecerles enormemente que hayan venido hoy, con todo y que hay partido, a acompañarnos y a oír la muy interesante cátedra que nos va a dictar el profesor Boris Grois. La Fundación de Amigos de las Colecciones del Banco de la República es una fundación que ya cumplió 15 años y que el objeto principal es el de ayudar a divulgar y promocionar el interés del público por las colecciones de arte y de orfebrería del Banco de la República. La cátedra es una vez al año y es de primordial importancia para nosotros porque ayuda a toda la academia a entender y a articular las colecciones del banco con los movimientos y los distintos planteamientos que van cambiando en el arte a nivel mundial. Entonces quiero pues agradecerles que estén acá. Voy a invitar al doctor Andrés Pardo Rodríguez, que es el coordinador de archivos digitales de la Universidad de los Andes, para que nos haga una breve presentación del profesor Grois. Y de nuevo, muchas gracias por su asistencia.
Buenas tardes. Boris Grois es filósofo, ensayista, teórico de los medios y crítico de arte. Es experto en arte y literatura de la Unión Soviética y la Rusia actual. Profesor del Departamento de Historia del Arte de la Universidad de Nueva York y profesor de filosofía de la Escuela Europea de Posgrados. Es autor de un gran número de libros, incluidos Volverse Público, Las Transformaciones del Arte en el Ágora Contemporánea, Sobre lo Nuevo, Ensayo de una Economía Cultural y Bajo Sospecha, una fenomenología de los medios. Ha sido curador de exposiciones como Fábrica de Sueños Comunismo, 2004 Frankfurt, Privatizaciones, 2004 Berlín, La Iluminación Total, Arte Conceptual en Moscú, 1960-1990, 2009 Frankfurt, y Después de la historia, Alexander Koshev, como fotógrafo, 2012, Utrecht. Sus trabajos orientados al arte moderno y contemporáneo son fruto de una reflexión sobre la modernidad y la posmodernidad y la cuestión del sujeto. Su obra tiene influencias de una variedad de filósofos modernos y posmodernos, como Derrida, Deleuze, Benjamin y Baudrillard. Thank you, Professor Grois, for joining us today. The floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much for invitation. It is, of course, a honor and also a very interesting experience for me to be here. And today I start a cycle of two lectures dedicated to the problem of the museum. And I divided the materials that I wanted to present to you in two parts. One part is what I presented today. it relates to the museum in a traditional sense. Museum as a place for permanent collection, and the museum as a national institution that creates a framework for the development of art. In the second part, so tomorrow, I will try to describe some shifts that happened to the museum. I would say in the period of contemporaneity. So in the last maybe 20, 30 years. Under the different influences, first of all, in the development of the art itself, an emergence of art events like performance happenings, interventions, actions, on the one hand, and on the other hand, emergence of the internet as a, let's say, a competitive platform for presenting art. So the museum today is confronted by these two challenges, and I will be speaking about them tomorrow. Today, let me speak about museum as an institution that formed itself predominantly through modernity. And from the beginning, the museum was a contested institution, maybe one of the most contested modern institution. There is a deep-rooted tradition in modernity of museum bashing, library bashing, or more generally, archive bashing, in the name of true life. The library and the museum are the preferred objects of intense hatred for a majority of modern writers and artists. Rousseau admired the destruction of the famous ancient library of Alexandria. Goethe's Faust was prepared to sign a contract with the devil if he could escape the library and the obligation to read his books. In the text of modern artists and theoreticians, the museum is repeatedly described as a graveyard of art and museum curators as grave diggers. According to this tradition, the death of the museum and of the art history embodied by the museum must be interpreted as a resurrection of true living art, a turning toward the true reality, life, toward a great other. If the museum dies, it is death itself that dies. However, why does art want to be alive rather than dead? And what does it mean for art to look as if it were alive? Now I'll try to show that it's the inner logic of the museum collecting itself, and generally of the archiving, that compels the artist to go into the reality, into life, and make art that looks as if it were alive. I shall also try to show that being alive means, in fact, nothing more or less than being new. And being new means being newly collected by the museum. First of all, the museum is actually a modern institution. Our contemporary notion of art has its roots in the French Revolution, in the decisions that were made by the French Revolutionary government concerning the object that this government inherited from the old regime. A change of regime, especially a radical change, such as the one introduced by the French Revolution, was usually accompanied by a wave of iconoclasm. One could follow these waves in the cases of Protestantism, Spanish conquest of the Americas, or the fall of the socialist regimes in Eastern Europe, but also in the Middle Age today. The French revolutionaries took a different course. Instead of destroying the sacred and profane objects belonging to the old regime, they defunctionalized or in other words, aestheticize them. The French Revolution turned the design of the old regime into what we today call art, that means objects not at use by pure contemplation. Yeah, before the introduction of the museums after the French Revolution, all the precious, beautiful objects were actually objects of use. They were objects of use in the context of a palace or in the context of church. And if we go in the other cultural areas, in a context of a temple, so in a context of a ritual. What happened after the French Revolution is that the objects, precious objects, of the old practices, life practices, were turned into the objects that could not be used but only looked at. It was quite a revolution in itself, because I was speaking about that yesterday, but maybe I repeat it here. The contemplation, vita contemplativa, as different from vita activa, so contemplation as different from practice, was always sought in analogy of difference between spirituality and material world. If you look at the traditional concept of contemplation from Plato, I would say up to phenomenology, up Husserl and even more, contemplation was always thought as contemplation of the spiritual evidence. It could be a contemplation of truth, or contemplation of mathematics, if you want, or logic, or contemplation of God, or Buddhist contemplation of nothingness. What's interesting about art is that art was the first time made out of material objects, the objects of pure contemplation. It was contested from both sides of the traditional divide. For the spiritualists, artworks are not spiritual enough. Yeah. For the materialist, they are, let's say, unjustly selected from all the material objects and put in a specific position that they actually do not deserve, being objects among many other objects. That is why museum is so contested. It is contested for both sides of this traditional divide. And if you look at our culture, we are still are living inside this divide. Our culture didn't change so much as we believe it changed. And so the museum as institution remains contested. It's interesting that if you look at the origin of the museum, it coincides practically with the origin of the modern aesthetics. Yeah, the Critique of Power of Judgment was actually written by Kant same year as a museum in Louvre was instituted. And in the beginning of his Critique of Judgment, he directly refers to this event, even if he doesn't mention Louvre as such. I quote now, "If someone asks me whether I find the palace that I see before me beautiful, I may well say I do not like that sort of thing. In true Rousseau-esque style, I might even vilify the vanity of the great who weighs the sweat of the people on such superfluous things. All of this might be conceded to me and approved, but what is not what is at issue here. One must not be in the least biased in favor of the existence of the thing, but must be entirely indifferent in this respect in order to play the judge in the matter of taste. So I can hate the Louvre as a place of power and admire it at the same time as a beautiful thing." Yeah. we have here for the first time a fundamental division between the concept of good and the concept of beautiful. This can be bad as a place of tyranny, but at the same time, it can be beautiful as an art object if it is not used but only looked at. Yeah. That was actually birth, the moment of birth of contemporary museum, contemporary aesthetics, and contemporary notion of art. Kant is not interested in the existence of a palace as a representation of wealth and power. However, he is ready to accept the palace as aestheticized, that is, negated, made non-existent for all practical purposes, returned to pure, or reduced to pure form. Here the inevitable question arises, what should one say about the decision by the French revolutionaries to substitute the aesthetic defunctionalization of the old regime for total iconoclastic destruction? And is a theoretical legitimation of this aesthetic defunctionalization that was proposed almost simultaneously by Kant a sign of the cultural weakness of the European bourgeoisie? Maybe it would be better to completely destroy the corpse of the old regime instead of exhibiting this corpse as art, as an object of pure aesthetic contemplation. In fact, one can argue that protection and conservation of art also presuppose the waste of sweat of the people. And one can further argue that the museum additionally stabilizes the existing relations of power, and that the museum is per se conservative and suppresses the true life by putting it into the service of the past and dead. So that is a question that haunted the museum all the two centuries, yeah, and more, that these institutions try to survive in 19th century and 20th century. However, the museum is not secondary to real history, and nor is it merely a reflection and documentation on what really happened outside its walls, according to the autonomous laws of historical development. The contrary is true. Reality itself, at least artistic reality, is secondary in relation to the museum. The real can be defined only in comparison with the museum collections and archives in general. This means that change in the museum collection brings about change in our understanding, in our perception of reality itself. After all, reality can be defined in this context as a sum of all things not being collected yet. So history cannot be understood as a fully autonomous process which takes place outside the museum's walls. Our image of reality is dependent on our memory and our museum, our archive. One case clearly shows this relationship more than any other archives. Art archives shows this relationship. Modern artists working after the emergence of the modern museum know, in spite of all their protests and resentments, that they are working primarily for the museum exhibitions, at least if they are working in the context of the so-called high art. These artists know from the beginning that they will be collected and exhibited in the museum. And they actually want to be collected and exhibited. Why dinosaurs didn't know that they would eventually be represented in museums of natural history? Artists, on the other hand, know that they may eventually be represented in the art museums. As much as the behavior of dinosaurs was, at least in a certain sense, unaffected and autonomous, in relationship to the future representation of the modern museum, the behavior of the modern artist is affected by the knowledge of such a possibility and even such an inevitability. This knowledge affects the behavior of artists in a very substantial way. Namely, it is obvious that the museum accepts not only things that it takes from the real life, from the outside of its collection, and it explains why the artist wants to make his or her art look real and alive. What I want to say is that the museification of art begins not after art is produced, but before art is produced. Yeah? It's not like you have independent artistic practice done and followed by the museum, selected and brought inside the museum. But the artists from the beginning are very well informed about the stance of the museum collections and exhibition practices of their time. And they want not to follow them, because follow them is ruinous, but to contradict them. The contradiction, the protest, and the revolt that the museum produced is integral part of the museum functioning itself. What is already presented in the museum is automatically regarded as belonging to the past, it's already dead. If outside the museum we encounter something that makes us think of the forms, position, and the approaches already represented inside the museum, we think it is kitsch. Yeah, what is kitsch? Kitsch is something that looks like museum art, but is made outside of the museum. That is the definition of kitsch, actually. So if the artist says that the majority of us say that he or she wants to break out from the museum, to go into life itself, to be real, to make a truly living art, that means only that this artist wants to be collected and exhibited. This is because the only possibility to be collected is to be different. So, I'll skip a passage. So, this interpretation, so if you are following the art historical paradigm, you look into the reality to find something new, what you didn't see in the museum yet. Of course, this interpretation of new, real, and living contradicts in certain deep-rooted conviction found in many texts of the early avant-garde, namely that the way into life can be opened only by the destruction of the museum and radical ecstatic deletion of the past, which stands between us and our present. This vision of the new is powerfully expressed, for example, in a short but important text by Kazimir Malevich on the museum from 1919. At that time, the new Soviet government feared that the old Russian museums and art collections would be destroyed by civil war and general collapse of the state institutions and the economy. And the Communist Party responded to that fear by repeating the gesture of French revolutionaries by creating the art collections. Malevich protested against this pro-museum policy of Soviet power, but calling on the state to not intervene on behalf of the old art collections because their destruction could open the path to true living art. In particular, he wrote, I quote, "Life knows what it is doing, and if it is striving to destroy, one must not interfere, since by hindering, we are blocking the path to a new perception of life that is born within us. In burning a corpse, we obtain 1 gram of powder. Accordingly, thousands of graveyards could be accommodated on a single chemist's shelf." It was a time as cremation was introduced as a kind of mass practice in Europe and Russia. "We can make a concession to conservatives by offering that they burn all past epochs, since they are dead, and set up 1 pharmacy. Later, Malevich gives a concrete example of what he means. The aim of this pharmacy will be the same even if people will examine the powder for Rubens and all his art. A mass of interesting ideas will arise in people and will be often more alive than actual representation and also takes less place. That is a brilliant idea, of course. That is a brilliant idea to organize a contemporary conceptual installation. That would be a perfect conceptual installation. The only problem is, and of course, Malevich did so as if he doesn't understand the problem. The problem is that this mass of interesting ideas would emerge in our souls only if we already know, already saw the Rubens art. If we imagine a situation that we never saw the Rubens art before, and only would see this installation with the ashes, from Rubens' paintings, we would just completely neutral in relation to that, and no ideas would emerge in us. So the only if these Rubens paintings would be still archived and presented by the museum, and besides these paintings, such an exhibition, such an installation by Malevich would be produced, that would be interesting effect, that would produce interesting effect. If the museum collection was effectually burned and abolished, this effect simply would not be produced. So I think the great failure of many artists contesting the museum would not to understand that the museum is a historical, is based on historicist ideology and not classicist ideology. The museum is ready to accept also things it doesn't like, if it is historically relevant. The principle of museum formation is very different from the principle of private collection formation. That is why I will be speaking about that tomorrow. But people say, today art market is so expensive, and so maybe we can substitute the museums by private collection. I don't think it is possible. At least it will change the functioning of art in our society. Because private collections, also feudal collections, also sovereign collection of the ancien regimes, they were governed and defined by a certain aesthetic taste, by a certain idea what is beautiful and how to present beauty to the public. This idea to be beautiful and to present something as beautiful to the public for a goal of, let's say, spiritual awakening of the public. This was very powerful. If you look at the even period of, let's say, beginning of the 9th century, you have this very famous stories from Italian, German, and French museums that the people were so fascinated by the beauty of the particular objects that they spent hours and hours contemplating them, and then they lost their consciousness, and should be medically supported. So, because they're too hungry or too thirsty or something like that. So they were in a condition of self-oblivion. What is very important for the traditional understanding of art, a traditional self-oblivion. And I in a certain period of my own practice, teaching and lecturing practice, I was lecturing for a group of famous European collectors, private collectors, the kind of group that organized seminar once in a year in Switzerland. And I was very much impressed by the, let's say, basically individual emotional connection of these people to the works they actually bought and had in the house. Yeah? And these works, they used, I would say, for psychological self-therapy, yeah, mostly. Yeah. They really were fascinated, and the psychic regime, yeah, the economy of their existence included this works of support. And you have this attitude until almost a middle of, let's say, 30s, in the middle of 9th century. And then suddenly, from Hegel and his school, we got a requirement to show ugly, unpleasant things. And interesting that the idea of galleries instead of spaces, round spaces or rooms, were proposed, introduced by Hegel. He said, as a main form of art representation for the Berlin Art Museum, first art museum that was built as an art museum, he said, it is good when the people don't stay for a long time in front of artworks and not be very much fascinated by them. Yeah, just that goes through the galleries, look left, look right, go further, don't spend a lot of time, yeah, in investigating them and looking at them. Then they repeat through the movements, through the gallery, they repeat the road that history took. Yeah, the root of history itself. Because the history is always on the move. And history mostly produced ugly things, not beautiful things. So you have to look at all the things history produced. You don't have to apply your own aesthetic judgment, but simply to follow by kind of enlightened way, yeah, follow in an enlightened, a subjective way, the objective course of history. So here we have a completely different concept of museum as a concept of private collections that preceded museum. Now, when I say that the museums provoke you, provoke the artist, provoke the current generation to do something new, I do not mean that they dictate to us how this new should look like. The museum doesn't dictate how the new has to look. It only shows what it must not look like. Functioning like a very famous demon of Socrates, who told Socrates what he must not do, but never what he must do. We can name this demonic voice, in our own souls, the inner curator. Yeah? It's a demon of our time. It's a curator, obviously. Even modern artist, every modern artist, has an inner curator, this inner voice, who tells the artist what is not longer possible to do. He doesn't tell artist what he has to do, but it tells him what is already over, what he cannot do anymore. Yeah. So what is not going to be collected and exhibited anymore? The museum gives us a rather clear definition of what it means for art to look real, alive, present. Namely, not to look museographed. That is condition of the new museum. And I would not read all the text, but just follow it by saying that if you look at the further developments of the museum, so let's say, because I follow that a bit, from the, let's say, 30s of the 19th century up to, let's say, end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, you see the museum as permanently expanding. Expanding in different directions. Expanding in collecting things produced by European civilization. By extending also by going outside of Europe and in the colonial areas and bringing things into the European museums from the non-European spaces. Now, it in a certain way, at the end of the 9th century, beginning of the 20th century, the museum came to an impasse, a certain impasse. And I would suggest that this impasse, I think it's more or less obvious, but maybe not in a way I will try to present it. This impasse was actually overcome by Duchamp. And I would suggest that Marcel Duchamp and his ready-mates was actually a return to the origin of the museum. It was a return to a first moment after the French Revolution. Yeah? Let us imagine the first moment after the French Revolution. Let us imagine the first revolutionary curator who actually has to make a selection from the things he inherited, yeah, from the old regime. And to say, that will be museographed, that will be not museographed. In a very interesting way, this kind of operation is very dangerous from the museum and for the private collections too. There's very famous stories about Roman vases and Greek statues that were broken and destroyed for not fitting into certain imperial collection or royal connections, collections in France, before Napoleon, after. So there is a kind of element of cruelty of that. I think what was interesting about the museum at the end of 19th century is that it began to look at the contemporary European culture, which developed on the industrial way after the Industrial Revolution, as something strange. Let us look, that mostly people like Malevich, looking at the museum from the perspective of contemporary art, so contemporary art beginning of the 20th century, saw that all this Venuses and Apollos, all this stuff are kind of strange. Not people you really meet in real life. So the question is why we should look at them. Yeah, they seem kind of not our contemporaries. But if you look at a contemporary culture from the museum perspective, that looks strange. You couldn't find a car in the museum. You couldn't find urinoir in the museum. You couldn't find these things that suddenly, from the perspective of museum director and museum curator, became strangely exotic. In a certain way, more exotic than the Chinese or Indian art of that time. And I think what was important for Duchamp and the fate of the museum collections after Duchamp is that he brought us back to this first moment of choice. I wrote a text about this moment using a figure from Kierkegaard, from Søren Kierkegaard, who also in a polemics against Hegel formulated this question: how we come to the choice in the, when we are confronted with something for the first time. And his example was Christianity. He says, let us imagine somebody living in the Palestine of a certain period of time and meeting a lot of people, each of them saying, I am a son of God. Yeah? He said it was practically every second. Yeah, a guy in the spirit of time said, I am son of God. And so I have to make a choice. For the first time, I have made a choice. I say, he is son of God and not you. Yeah? And this kind of first choice for a movement cannot be erased, cannot be relativized, and cannot be suspended by the historical development, because it is always possible that the choice was the wrong one. The fact that this choice has established itself as normative is not a legitimation of this choice if we look at it retrospectively as a first choice. This polemics by Kierkegaard against Hegel. I was reminded of this polemic thinking about Duchamp. Think about Duchamp as somebody who tried to make an archaeology of contemporary life, who tried to make a first choice in an area of objects that nobody before considered as an area out of which choice can be done. In many cases, the history of the archaeology and maybe the tragedy of history makes this choice for us here. All this, you know, remains of the antiquity. We never made a choice. Yeah, we actually made a choice only among very few objects that survived centuries and centuries, yeah, and that we were able to discover and to unearth through archaeological research. So what does it mean to make a choice here and now? What does it mean to make a choice for the first time at the first moment of the museum? In a certain way, this was repeated. I don't know if you remember the original form in which pop art for the first time was shown end of the 50s by independent group. If you look at the original design, the title was Archaeology of Contemporary Life. And all these objects of contemporary life were connected or were shown in a context of pseudo archaeological objects. So this archaeological view of contemporaneity is the beginning of contemporary experience of the museum. How this experience is actually structured? It is structured in a strange and not quite clear way. Namely, the curator does not make this choice. So in fact, the curators decided not to make this choice and to delegate this choice to the artists. If I am an artist, I can take a primary ready-made. Yeah? I can make a choice and say, for me, this object is my work of art. But curator cannot do it. The decision of curator inside our museum system is always mediated by the decision of an artist. That is actually how it happened at the beginning, yeah. It's interesting that Duchamp himself has chosen Urinoir as a curator. Yeah, he was a co-curator of the exhibition, and he organized the sending of this object to the group of curators, exhibition curators, and he pleaded for this object to be included. This object was not included, and so he left his curatorial position. And in this sense, he created this kind of very strange ambiguity between artist and curator. This ambiguity didn't exist before, because it was clear the artist creates something and produces something, and then the curator makes a choice. But in a situation of ready-made, this difference between act of exhibiting things and act of producing things, this difference is erased. So that we exhibiting things mean producing, and producing things mean exhibiting them. So you have an identity between artistic gesture and artistic production, and action, curatorial action of exhibition. So we have this difficulty, and this difficulty informs our museum's practices, because speaking about ready-made, we not only speak about, let's say, things, objects, we speak about photography, for example. How we make a choice of photographs, a choice of filmic material, choice of documentary material. In all these cases, there is a certain indecidability between the position of the artist and of the curator. This choice is always artistic choice and curatorial choice at the same time. That is a new condition under which the museum exists already for some decades, and for a very long time, even in the 60s and even 70s, people believed that that is a kind of slippery slope, that it is a kind of condition that destroys the museums. If you look at the books of the 60s and beginning of the 70s, published all around the world, all of them were about museum ruins, about crushing the museum before the museum is not able to, let's say, not able to include everything that it has to include. We began to be confronted with the politics of inclusion. Yeah? And then the museum was understood as based and defined by politics of exclusion. Yeah? At the moment that we do not anymore dissociate between ready-made and artwork, photography and painting, cinema and sculpture and so on, we are not able to legitimize completely, yeah, our decision, because our decision to include something or to exclude something is always a decision that includes, so to say, or presupposes an artistic gesture. Yeah, that is, yeah. Curator ceased to be curator. He began to be partially an artist. And that create a new situation of creative curators, independent curators, figures like Harald Seiman, yeah, Obrist, and so on and so on. So all these figures emerged as a reaction of the artistic system toward a new condition of artistic production. So at the moment the artist begins to act artistically as a curator, is obliged, yeah, it can escape the necessity to act partially as an artist. He cannot say, I am only a curator, yeah, because his choice of inclusion or exclusion is always under suspicion of being too subjective, too artistically determined. Yeah. That is a new kind of suspicion under which the contemporary museum system works. And now let me, I hate that to tell the particular cases, yeah, because it's a theoretical lecture, but still, let me bring at the end of my lecture, or near to the end of my lecture, and a kind of telling experience of that. It was some years ago, and I was invited to open in I think it was in Basel, no, it was in Zurich, to open an exhibition of the huge installation of Fischli Weiss. Installation, a big table. So huge table, and on this huge table, you could find objects that are real objects, so ready-made, and then the copies, simulation of this object, that were made also polyurethane. Yeah, polyurethane. It is a kind of material that gives you a possibility to make pretty precise copies of the objects because it's very plastic. At the same time, it's very light. It's very lightweight. So you would take these objects in your hand, you immediately see the difference. If you look from a certain distance, it is almost impossible. And so we began the day sitting on this table with Fischli and Weiss, drinking wine and taking these objects in our hands and comparing the weight. Okay, then I come same day. I see the same table in the exhibition. And then I try to explain people how it works. I took an object, immediately all the system of protection and so outside worked, and the police came, arrested me, and I should be then saved by the director of the Kunsthalle. And then I realized that the police is not informed about the theories concerning erasure of difference between a life and art. Yeah, they didn't read this book. Yeah. For them, the difference is only one. Are things officially protected and insured, or they are not protected and insured? Yeah? That is a basic difference. And this difference cannot be simply undermined by discourse. It can be deconstructed by kind of post-Derridian reflection of how I define originality and so on and so on. So on. In effect, we have only five urinoirs in different museums, contemporary museums, that are officially protected. All other urinoirs are not protected, as you know. And this difference is more or less obvious. That's point number one. The point number two is that the museum, standard museum exhibition, was based on a certain kind of assumption that we know the material substance of the exhibited and presented works. So if I have to do with traditional paintings, or with paperwork, or with different kinds of sculpture, I could, so to say, recognize the material substance of the object, materiality of the object, by just looking at them. Yeah? So to say, the medium was obvious to me. And that is what very much a basis of, for example, in many ways very critical and profound, in many ways superficial analysis by, for example, Clement Greenberg, speaking about showing the medium. But I can show the medium as an image, so I can turn the medium in the image only if I have, if I trained in visual recognizability of artistic mediality, yeah, of artistic mediums. If I begin to substitute, like Fischler and Weiss did it, and like many artists in our time do, if I begin to substitute one material substance for another material substance inside the artwork, so I do the operation that is not recognizable from the gaze of the spectator, then I cannot say what this object is as such, yeah, taken out of the museum exhibition. That is obvious for the curator. The curators know that. Maybe cleaning lady knows that. You know these very famous stories about cleaning ladies destroying part of the Joseph Beuys work because they didn't recognize the medium. Yeah. So maybe they do that, but not the spectator. So we have a very strange new break between the show, between the surface of what I see in the museum and assumption concerning the material status of the objects that I see. It was not so obvious at the beginning of the 19th century and 20th century museum, but it's pretty obvious today. So there is kind of internal material and materialist knowledge that separates me from the museum's object, because I cannot touch them, I cannot use them, I cannot go into them, I can destroy them and see what they are made out of. So if we look at the avant-garde and late avant-garde polemics against the museum, this polemics very much was about reality of the museum objects, make the things real. And indeed, you cannot keep this reality inside the museum space, in a sense that material substance, as I said, singleness of the object disappears. So we have a certain kind still, notwithstanding all the, you know, practices of ready-made and early avant-garde and materialist turn in the relationship to the artistic objects, the museum staging creates a certain specific condition of difference between inside and outside. And that is precisely what I will try to explain, to thematize next time. So how contemporary curators work with this difference, or try to erase this difference, or try to exploit this difference. So I would almost say that the majority of contemporary, so to say, creative curatorship goes around this problem of difference between surface manifestation and inner material structure of the artistic objects. Okay, that's it. I'm an end.
I'm wondering, now that you're talking about the space of inside and outside in the museum, I'm wondering what your opinion is of the movement started by the L'Internazionale, the confederation of the six major European museums, and how they envisioned this idea of the museum as a network. And other artists such as Tomás Sarraceno, who has engaged with the same idea of opening up the space of the museum's network, which is, I mean, of course it's always been like that, at least in terms of exchange of knowledge and different approaches to aesthetics and many other value systems, but the fact that they're using it as a curatorial strategy of producing not only work, but a discourse, I wonder what your opinion is in relation to that.
First of all, my opinion is biased, because you speak about France. But on the other hand, I would suggest that it's a problem, that cannot be easily solved. Even if the museum built a network, there is still a problem of the access to this network. Obviously, some people have this access and some people don't. Some institutions are part of this exchange system. Institutions are not. The question is, of course, to what degree you should be, it's a basic question, to what degree you should be informed on what happens inside the art system, inside the museum, inside the networks of the museum, criteria of choice, discussions, attitudes, work with material. Should you be informed about that? To be a good spectator, or the art should tend to be democratic, not in a sense of creating access to some kind of knowledge, but being open potentially for everybody. That is a very also difficult problem. There is always a danger in understanding art as a kind of knowledge or practice in which one should participate to get access to it. So if you say this system should be open for the participation, what does it mean? It is closed for the people who are not participating. That is a complicated question. Of course, you shift all the lines that divide the museum from the spectators. You give the spectators additional access, and you make the museum more transparent. But still, a certain kind of division between having access, being able to participate, not having access, not being able to participate. This division line still exists, even if it has shifted in a certain way.
¿Alguien más?
Good evening, Mr. Grois. I would like to know if the internet behaves like a museum somehow.
No. There's a simple answer. The simple answer is no. In many ways, but let's say in two very decisive ways. First of all, the museum is a public institution, accessible for everybody. Not in the sense I discussed before. So to what degree you understand the mechanism of museums and inner workings and so on. But in general, you come into the museum as a public space, yeah, as a public space, defined as a neutral space. But internet is not a neutral space. Yeah, it's not a public space. First of all, it is owned by companies or by corporations. Secondly, you are under surveillance of different kind. And then, what is most important, you cannot look at the internet. Yeah, you cannot be spectator of the internet. You have to be God to be spectator of internet. Yeah, as a human being, you cannot look at the internet. In a sense, you can look at the museum. And what happens is that internet creates a very basic fragmentation of the public space. If you look at actually internet is working, people mostly looking at what their friends are doing. Yeah. I'm teaching in New York, but that's really extreme. And my students mostly get all the information from the internet. Not only they do not read any books that are generally published, or look at any movies that are on the screens at the movie theaters. They look basically on the movies their friends are doing, or they're reading the text that the friends are writing. Yeah, and if you are not a friend, you have no access to that. And so you have a parcellation and fragmentation of the public space that you couldn't imagine even, let's say, a couple of years ago, maybe 5 years ago. And then, as I said, what is a promise of the museum, a real promise, is a promise of, let's say, secular infinity. This secular infinity or secular immortality was what the secular state, French state, and other secular states proposed to the citizens instead of spiritual immortality, instead of Christianity. So if they inscribe themselves in a cultural, into the cultural archives, the name will be kept. The books will be republished. The paintings will be restored, cared of, and so on and so on. I also remember what Nietzsche said once. He was everything about, explosion of energies, destruction of everything, and so on and so on. But he was a typical European, and he said, the European mankind will understand me in 300 years. Yeah? What does it mean? He believed that European mankind will keep his books, republish them, keep them accessible to the public without understanding them, yeah? Without even getting what it's all about. Yeah? Maybe 300 years ago. We don't have this expectation now, yeah? At least contemporary internet system doesn't give us this promise. Websites emerge and they disappear. There is no system that guarantees stability, sustainability of the cultural memory. Yeah? So I would say two points here. One is the fragmentation of public space. And second one is extreme lack of sustainability.
¿Alguna otra pregunta?
Good night. How do you see life for art outside museums and collections? How do you see life for art outside the museums and collections?
If you are going through the museum, in many museums, maybe a majority of the museums, the most beautiful view is a view through the window. And this view through the window is incomparably more beautiful than all the art objects. It is something that already Kant has shown. He said that after 10 minutes speaking about art, he simply goes out of the room to look at nature, yeah, because he couldn't stand it. So the museum art in general produce in us some kind of feeling of, there's very German, a good German word, Unbehagen, a kind of discontent with it, yeah? We're always, but even we're fascinated art. But this whole, you know, sticky air, this whole control, don't move, yeah, don't be too loud. At the same time, this crowd that always push you, they don't give you, yeah, this whole produce some kind of discontent. And you think, maybe I go out of it, yeah? I go outside and find something that would be aesthetically relevant for me. And if I'm an artist, a curator, I find it and bring it back into the museum. Yeah? That's I think, how the museum produces in you this kind of longing to go outside of it. And that is a way how the museum constitutes the outside space. It constitutes the outside space at this space of desire, the space of longing, at the space of nostalgia for the real experience.
¿Alguien más quiere hacer una pregunta?
You explained like this impulse towards preservation. In terms of the emergence of modernity in some sense, but now memory studies and many other thinkers have also told us that there is a kind of musealization of experience. Like there is a museum outside the museum. In some sense, we all have museums now in some way. We preserve a lot more than people used to do it a century ago, let's say. So how does this musealization affect the sense of, the definition of the museum as being something, in terms of tracing this inside and outside?
Yes, in a very profound way. I would say that the museum, the promise of the museum, is a promise that is given to me as an artist, maybe the same as a library of the writer. And it is a promise to be able to break with my memories, not to keep my memories, but to reject my memories, to reject the my immediate surrounding, to reject my humanity, to take a certain kind of meta position in relationship to it. That was mobilized people for a very long time. That is why, for example, Malevich, I just quoted him, said the artist should never be sincere. She would always act against sincerity. Yeah. He'll always try to break with his own subjectivity, to break with his own surroundings, to break with his own psychology. Why? Because working for the museum in art history, you create a distance, a critical distance in relationship to your immediate surrounding. Yeah? You can have a critical attitude toward contemporaneity. You are not in the, yes, the word contemporary is actually very good because it's not temporary. Yeah, it's contemporary. It means be with the time. It doesn't mean be in time. It means to be with the time. That means that presuppose the possibility of metaposition. So, if this kind of promise is not given, then the possibility to take a contemporary, and that means meta-temporary position is reduced, and that means also the possibility to take a critical position toward your own contemporaneity is reduced. You are then too much inside your own time. And that is what I think characteristic also for our time. Indeed, we can say a lot of negative words about historicism. At least the historicism, the whole Hegelian, post-Hegelian tradition from Hegel over Marx, yeah, and after Derrida in some way, all this big Hegelian tradition at least creates a distance between your own time, gives you a possibility to look at it from the other perspective. And I think it would be a kind of fatal development, if we only would carry our own museum with us, yeah, instead of destroying it and do something completely different, yeah, yeah.
How do you see the relationship between the art market and the development of the museums right now?
Yeah, another complicated question. First of all, there's a competition. Yeah, there's a competition, and especially if you go into the areas where the museum tradition was weak for a very long time, for example, in China, in Asian countries, you immediately see that the internet is a big chance. But internet is a big chance also in New York, for example, where you have around 50,000 artists only in Brooklyn. Yeah? So how you get access to the public beyond selection, beyond all that? Yeah? You can do that by internet, by using internet. And internet became a kind of alternative with all the negative problems that I just enumerated between art market, museum system, and great exhibition system. I would say we have four main institutions in the contemporary culture. One is a museum, one is the art market, one is a, let's say, biennialization of art, yeah, creation a huge international exhibition, and internet. Now, museums are, for good or for bad, are national institutions. We tend to speak about globalized art, we tend to speak about international art, but the museums are actually always national museums. We don't have something like an international museum. Yeah? Not a museum that tries to show international art, national museum that tries to show international. There are such examples. Yeah? But we don't have global museum system. So big exhibitions like biennials, like Documenta, try to compensate this lack of international institutions. Yeah? So we can say that there are every such Documenta, every such biennial is kind of project of the museum of global art that is always only temporary. Yeah? And then if we ask how the curators get the information, partially from the art market or partially from the internet. Yeah. So I wouldn't say that the art market very much, it dominates in a certain way, of course, contemporary art, but not completely, and maybe less and less. Art market more and more begins to look like a luxury goods production machine, yeah, something like that. Yeah. And that's some kind of exclusive kitsch, yeah. And that, yeah, production of exclusive kitsch. And that, this kind of activity is very problematic, yeah. Also, if you want to create a really interesting program and a really interesting exhibition program, you actually should avoid it, yeah. So how you get the information? You get the information through the agencies, yeah, through the platforms, internet platforms, conferences, meetings, traveling, and so on and so on. So I don't, the art market is important, but I think that its role in our understanding of contemporary art and art situation is exaggerated.
So you don't think that one legitimizes the other?
No, I don't think so. Because look, if you, of course you have to maneuver, yeah. But you have this tradition, yeah, you have this tradition of contemporary art is structurally, formally, is in tradition of avant-garde, yeah? So as people say, avant-garde is our antiquity, yeah? So like academisms and realisms in the 19th century, antiquity is Greek-Roman antiquity, our antiquity is actually avant-garde, yes, in some way. And so we inherited this idea that commercial artist is actually bad artist. To say he is too commercial, it's not a good characterization of an artist, yeah? We have this kind of paradoxical relationship to the market. Art market is not like every other market. It's not structured as every other market. And the reason for that is that we don't have any need or desire for art, yeah? If you, for example, look at the market for, I don't know, refrigerator, yeah. People need refrigerators, yeah, really. So they are interested maybe in this design and that design, but basically they are interested in refrigerators. But they are not basically interested in art. So art is a market when demand precedes, offer precedes the demand. Yeah, I'm interested in art, I'm also interested in buying art, only if I see something that really attracts my attention, yeah, and so on and so on. Or something I believe in, too. But the people believe into it, they're going to somebody who is, I don't know, art market advisor. And this art market advisor say, ah, he's too commercial, she's too commercial. Let's look, yeah, it's better to go to the other artist who is not so commercial but more promising, yeah, so, so. So you have a completely different structure inside the art market itself. And the art market is only part, yeah, it's only a fragment of the whole ways in which art is produced and distributed. For example, if you look at the European and American art system, and I look at the artists, even very famous artists, They cannot support the living here by selling to the art market. They are professors. There are hundreds and hundreds, thousands of professors of art in American institutions here. And they're functioning very efficiently, but they're functioning completely circumventing here, the art market system. So it's much more complicated than the art market.
La haré en español. Se podría entender la figura del museo como una figura que siempre.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay. Se podría entender la figura del museo como una figura
no,
que
no,
siempre.
No, no, no. I have no translation. It's on them, but I have not. Now. Yeah, I can hear.
¿Ya? ¿Ahí? ¿Se podría entender la figura del museo como una figura que siempre existirá absorbiendo los movimientos, inclusive en contra de la misma figura, o tiene la posibilidad la figura del museo en transformarse en algo más? Si es así, ¿hacia qué camino se dirigiría?
I will speak about that tomorrow. So, but at the moment I can only say that what constituted the museum, as I said, is this promise. It is promise of protection. It is promise of a kind of trans-temporal, physical, material, immortality of certain objects. The question to what degree ideologically, politically, socially, and economically our contemporary societies are willing and able to pull this through, it's an open question. Yeah, it's an open question. Already now, and I will speak about it tomorrow. Already now, museums, at least leading museums in the Western world, function more as stages for the performing of different kind of events and temporary exhibitions. That means that at least institutionally and the imagination of the public, they kind of shifted from keeping things to performing them. Now, if I ask myself what is actually archiving work, and where I can find the archiving work, the answer is very complicated. In this sense, it was very interesting to look at the restaging or reperforming the exhibition of when the attitudes become form, yeah. That was made on the Venice Biennale, I think, couple of years ago, 4 years ago, yeah. At the moment, we will see that we have an event, exhibition as an event, not as a part of the permanent exhibition, but at a closed in itself event in time. And to reconstruct this event or to restage it or to reperform it, it's very difficult. And Harald Zeman understood that very well. We'll speak about his projects later, so tomorrow, but this time dimension, introduction of the time dimension into the museum practice itself is what actually happens now, yeah? To what degree it completely transforms museum, or will museum completely abolish or give up this promise? It is an open question for me. I think at the moment it's difficult to answer this question simply.
¿Alguien más?
related what you explained about Malevich. On your book, Going Public, you have a whole chapter about this issue where you explain that Malevich agreed that artwork shouldn't be protected and just let it be destroyed. And you said that Malevich wanted the image to survive despite destruction. And he said that the image that would survive this, would survive destruction, was the image of destruction itself. Yeah. And his answer for that was the black square. So I was wondering, nowadays we overproduce images. There's a lot of production of images nowadays. Do you think there's a way to destroy this mass production of image to create something new, or we should just let it go as Malevich wanted to artworks to be destroyed?
It's always it's all a question, after all, the attitude. You know, it's difficult to say what we have to do, yeah? Let us see the options. Of course, Malevich and Marinetti even, yeah, at the beginning of the Futurist movement. I don't know if you remember Futurist Manifesto. It's about war and hygiene of the world and also hate of women and so on and so on. But at the beginning, before he begins to write the manifesto itself, he tells a story about him trying to drive very fast a car that he got, yeah. And he actually went into a gutter, yeah, and in a crash, he crashed this car, yeah. So the whole Futurist Manifesto is already about crashing the Futurist project. Yeah. It's about it's about project and impossibility to realize it. So it's always already about the destruction, failure, yeah, lack of temporal and transtemporal security. Yeah. Now, the way how you can keep and not keep this this kind of event of failure, it's of course through documentation, through description. In fact, you cannot understand Black Square in the sense I described it if you don't read Malevich's explanation of that. Yeah, after all, it's everything about the text. So at the moment, art begins to function not as production of the autonomous object, but as rather production of impossibility of production of this object. Yeah? And that is radical modernity. Yeah? Then you move from the world of objects into the world of texts and textual memories. Yeah? We can trace from Marinetti up to Deleuze and some radical post-Deleuzian movements today, this kind of dream of total failure, yeah, dream of total destruction, of experience of death in the middle of life, yeah, all this kind of romantic, neo-romantic imagination, neo-Nietzschean imagination. All of that can be only described, it can be fixed as an image. Yeah. On the other hand, we can try also to give a chance to everyday experience, give a chance to some kind of strange gestures, maybe deviating gestures, maybe non-normative gestures, forms of behavior, and so on, so on, and give them a kind of perspective of eternity or perspective of museum. It is a kind of different or opposite strategy. But the interesting that in the modernity, this strategy operates in a parallel ways. Yeah, we can say that we have to make a choice. Yeah, we look at we should see ourselves as heirs of certain history, as heirs of certain heritage. And this heritage is a heritage of a radical revolt, destruction, self-destruction of the one hand, and on the other hand, is a heritage of trying to bring to our attention and to stabilize something that in itself disappears. Yeah, it seems to be paradoxical, but it's not the case. So what is stable should be destroyed. What is unstable, what is fleeting, what is everyday, should be fixed and memorized. Yeah, it is a kind of strange, paradoxical, but at the same time, compensatory practices. Yeah, that in their ambivalence create the strategy of modernity, and we inherited this modernity and this structure in its entirety. Yeah, it doesn't compel us to make this choice and that choice. Yeah, it just opens these choices. Yeah, we are open. We have some options. Yeah, that we can realize. Yeah.
Voy a decirlo en español. Bueno, desde finales del siglo XX y hasta la actualidad, muchos museos, incluso los que no son de arte, han llamado y han asumido programáticas o programas en los que llaman artistas para que actualicen de alguna manera sus e interpreten sus colecciones. Si el arte actualiza las relaciones y las estructuras institucionales, ¿cómo podría también ese proceso ser recíproco y actualizar también el arte? Pensando, por ejemplo, en un programa de un museo de ciencias naturales que llama a un artista o que el artista propone intervenir en la colección.
Well, I think there is kind of a difference between science and art, at least as understood in modernity. Science is always developing, yeah? It's developing, and new theory is better than the old theory. But so we exchange always new iPhone, we take new iPhone, and we reject old iPhone. And we update us all the time, yeah. Our life in technology and science is permanent updating and self-updating. But there's one level of our existence that's always the same. And I think art reflects this. We are born, we die, yeah. Still, yeah, nothing changed. No science, no technology can change that. Whatever we do and say remains ununderstood, at least in our imagination, not understood as it should be, and so on. So there's always this communication, there's also failure, there's always a project impossibility to realize it. Yeah, there's kind of very stable parameters of human existence. In one way or another, it guarantees the stability of art. That's why we have the museum. Yeah, we don't say we're updating the museum in a sense that we just throw away what is thought before because it's not up to the conscience of our time, and do something new. That would be betrayal of the art project. Art project is a project of certain stability inside the unstable way. But this stability, as Marinetti shows us, is in many cases stability of tragedy, unhappiness, with failure. Yeah? So it's not only happy stability, not always happy stability. It's in many cases unhappy stability or stability of unhappiness, let's say.
Yo también tengo una pregunta en español.
acá. Quisiera saber cuál es tu opinión respecto a las nociones de museo que están cambiando en la actualidad respecto a la realidad virtual, y lo hablo desde una experiencia bastante particular que tuve con un programa que se llama Second Life, en la que las personas acceden y pagan con dinero real para construir su propio mundo allá. Y lo que sucede es que hay un espacio, que es como el mundo del arte, en el que cada persona puede construir su propio museo. Y hay miles de museos Louvre, por ejemplo. Y hay réplicas de obras como de Rodin, por ejemplo, o réplicas de pinturas de Da Vinci, y cada persona está haciendo su propia curaduría, obviamente no muy seria, porque se ha visto como un juego, pero creo que es una noción que se va a expandir, dado que estamos entrando en una nueva noción de presencia en este mundo virtual, en donde se está borrando la noción de temporalidad, de sensaciones, por ejemplo. ¿Cómo es el futuro del museo respecto a esto?
I agree, it's interesting development today. So everybody makes selfies. Nobody looks at images of the others, yeah. I think the problem is not the problems of institutions, it's the problems of spectatorship. We lost the spectatorship, yeah. And the ability of spectatorship, yeah. Guy Debord wrote this very famous societal spectacle. Spectacle is still there, but no spectators. Yeah. Everybody is writing and nobody is reading. And now everybody will be creating his or her own museum and curating own programs and not going to the public museums. That is kind of museum selfies, yeah, selfies as museum. That is possible, and I don't see, of course, any negative side of it. I think it's very interesting development. In general, it is interesting development because it has some kind of very moving, very sentimental, confessional side in it, kind of Catholic confessional side of it. I made from myself my own museum. That is how I am. Yeah, I confess to myself what I am. Yeah, or I made a selfie and confessed to myself how I look like if I am photographed. Yeah, and so on and so on. It's a very interesting self-reflective, neo-narcissistic, I would say, neo-narcissistic because productive. Yeah. You know, old narcissists just looked at the lake, yeah, and it was enough, yeah. But contemporary narcissists makes own museums, writing own text, yeah, producing own images. They are working all the time, yeah. They are not passive, yeah, and they are not dying, yeah, from this passive attitude of self-reflection. It's a kind of active, productive, permanent work on self-reflection, yeah, on self-confession. That's very interesting, and that is very mythological. Yeah, I think also virtual reality is actually mythological. Yeah, going to mythological time, in a mythological, not a transcendent time, but mythological time. I meet mythological figures. I was participating in creation of time of. Second Life projects, yeah, the other day. So they are basically, it's a kind of market mythology and mythologizing the market exchange, yeah. It's a mythological site of exchange, it's exchanged as part of the mythology. It's a very interesting development. I am absolutely fascinated by that, I agree.
Over here. I wanted to ask, I liked a lot that regression into the history of museums that you did. And I was wondering, with the relationship between museum and education, you know, we are now in a moment in history in which no cultural museum or no cultural institution such as galleries or biennials is complete without a educational project, right? So I wanted to ask if you see, well, perhaps this is a little bit biased question, but I wanted to ask if you see this relationship between museum and education something that is deeply rooted in these origins in the French Revolution, or it is some kind like making useful the museum that in a way became something that wasn't useful anymore because of this aestheticization or over-aestheticization of objects.
Yes, of course, museum was an educational institution and closely connected to education, so university education, education in art history, university discipline, and so on. So. But it seems to me, maybe I'm wrong here, but it seems to me that a lot of what is presented as education today is actually advertisement for the, it's not education, it's advertisement. And it's not about educate people, but explain them to them how great it all is, wonderful, and they should come another time, yeah, so something like that. Is it good or bad? It's part of our time. Our time needs advertisement. Well, I would myself not be involved in this process.
¿Alguien más tiene alguna pregunta?
Hello. In a disciplinary society as the one we live in, where a museum controls the art, art dictates what art is, isn't art already a failure because it's not an act of resistance anymore?
Well, it's again a difficult question. I will think about that next day. But for example, if you look precisely at the middle of 19th century, many thinkers and artists of that time, for example, and in a very influential way, Wagner, propagated the idea that art doesn't need spectator at all. His example was, for example, the festivals, carnivals, collective dancing, collective singing, yeah? It's all activities and practices that do not presuppose any outside position and any outside aesthetic attitude. Aesthetic attitude is always a meta attitude in a certain way. But we can imagine, we are not there now, but we can imagine artistic practice, Marx writes about it, artistic practice without spectator as immediate impulse coming from the individual as a manifestation of energies, of vital, maybe sexual energies that are inside, that operate inside an individual and bring this individual to think, to dance, maybe to write something, maybe to draw something. So we don't need necessarily the other, yeah? It's an interesting and at the moment, maybe really unthinkable option, yeah? The art without the spectator, the art without the other, but it is a possibility. And if it is a possibility, then we can say art survives, yeah, it survives everything. Lack of institutions, lack of information, lack of exchange, lack of spectatorship. there is this kind of drive, yeah, that can be satisfied only this way, yeah, so it will persist. But I have a feeling that we are moving toward closure of this section of our discussions, and so next day maybe we can continue.